Harsha, I feel that there is no right without a duty. Unless we all discharge our duties, nobody will be in a position to enjoy the rights. For example, we have right to life and liberty. But if we do not protect the life and liberty of others, ours will also be at stake.
Greetings, ladies and gentlemen. Today it is an honor and a pleasure for me to introduce you all to this very particular session where we are going to know more about our fundamental duties. My name is Harsh and I'm going to moderate this session for all of you, wherein I'm going to introduce you all about this session and perhaps the person who is going to interact and address all of us. First of all, I request you all to kindly acknowledge and welcome the presence of our esteemed guest, Mr. Kaiser Khalid sir, who is here with us. I would like to request all the persons, those who are watching this session on YouTube, to kindly upload in the comment section and welcome the presence of our guest. Mr. Kaiser Khalid sir is currently working as Inspector General of Police in Maharashtra Police Headquarters, Mumbai. He has served in number of different capacities and in challenging roles during his career spanning over 23 years in police in the state of Maharashtra. He has been widely published author and poet. He has authored two books. First one is Savore Ashr, The Consciousness of Time, and the second one is Daste-Jaan, The Wilderness of the Soul. He was awarded the State Sahitya Award for Literature on his book Savore Ashr in the year 2015 by the Government of Maharashtra. He has recited his poetry in India and the abroad. He has been awarded Indian Business and Professional Council Dubai Award for Leadership. And I believe his profile has so many things, so many glories, which I won't be able to explain in the next few minutes. But I'm pretty sure during this conversation, we are going to learn a lot from him. So first of all, sir, I welcome you to in this session. Thank you so much for joining and agreeing to share your thoughts with us. We are extremely very happy to have you for today's talk.
Thank you, Ash. Thank you for calling me.
Thank you so much, sir. It's our pleasure. So, sir, moving to the topic of today's session, which we have chosen is need to remember our fundamental duties as we remember our fundamental rights. Sir, do you think every responsible citizen of this nation need to remember our fundamental duties as we remember our fundamental rights?
Harsha, I feel that there is no right without a duty. Unless we all discharge our duties, nobody will be in a position to enjoy the rights. For example, we have right to life and liberty. But if we do not protect the life and liberty of others, ours will also be at stake. We have a right to freedom of speech and expression. That does not mean that we would say anything to anybody. We will abuse somebody. Understand one thing, the moral foundation of any law is based on the premise that life, possessions, and dignity of every person must remain intact and protected. That is why we as citizens have surrendered some of our freedom to create an institution called state. And it is the responsibility of the state to ensure protection of all these things. That is the protection and guarantee of life, of possessions, that is property and dignity of all its citizens. So unless we discharge our responsibilities, unless we ensure and create such conditions in which all of us are able to enjoy these rights, these freedoms, nothing and nobody will be able to enjoy these things. For example, places where life is not protected, areas which are affected by terrorism, areas which are affected by insurgency, areas where a lot of conflicts are going on across the globe. Are their lives protected? No, they are not. Bomb blast can take place at any point of time. Anybody can come and shoot. Anybody come and dispossess you, loot your property. Anybody can blow up your vehicle. Imagine what is the condition of life in at those places. So unless we discharge our responsibilities as citizens, and what are our responsibilities? Our responsibility is this, that every right comes with a limitation. Every right comes with certain parameters. Every right has certain restrictions imposed upon it by its very nature. Because we as human beings have got two fundamental capabilities. One is that we have willpower, and second that we have capability to exercise that will. And as experience has shown us, that many of us would misuse these facilities. We will do something which will be injurious to life, property, or dignity of somebody else. We may use our discretion in a in unjustified manner, creating troubles. We may trample upon the right of other people also. And human by nature has a tendency to control this. Therefore, what will happen, that there will be no order, there will be chaos in the society. So unless we ensure that we, the part of the rights that we have surrendered, the part of freedom that we have surrendered, in lieu of a stable government, in lieu of formation of a state, which will ensure that everybody, irrespective of his caste, class, or position in life, or age, or sex, or region, or religion, or language, whatever may be the pointer or basis, has these freedoms ensured for his exercise. Therefore, we must ensure that our responsibilities are discharged first. Then only the question of enjoying the rights will emerge. Yes. Take an example. I am from a state called Bihar. And at some point of time, the law and order situation was not very good. So I remember that as a student, when we were to catch a train to go somewhere late in night, we would go in the evening at the station and we will stay put, keep waiting, because night travel was not safe from the city to the station. We would have been afraid. Similarly, suppose if the roads are in bad shape, all the motorists would be affected. Even if you are having a Mercedes or BMW, you will also face similar problems as a person who is having a motorcycle. Life and liberty and dignity of people will remain intact only when all of us discharge our responsibilities. So I completely agree with this premise or thesis that there is no right without a corresponding duty.
Indeed, sir, you have very beautifully explained, and I'm impressed by your answer. I think the viewers, those who are watching this session, they are surely going to understand this. Not only I think, but I do strongly believe this, sir. Sir, my next question to you is, and I'm sure you must have tackled this question more than 500 times, but I'm still asking you, sir, why do you have chosen to become an IPS officer? What are the reasons you opt for civil services?
The first part of the question. Why somebody chooses to be an IPS officer, or for that matter, a police officer? If I would have been wearing my uniform right now, there was no need for me to describe myself or introduce myself. The moment you would see the uniform, you'll realize I'm somebody who is belonging to police department, who is the part of the government. So uniform gives you immediate identity, one. Number two, it gives you an opportunity to serve people when they are in distress. I may not be able to increase their income. I may not be able to ensure education of their children. But yes, I'll be able to ensure the protection of his life, his possessions, and his dignity to the best possible manner. One. Number two, there are a lot of injustices in the society, and people need an agency who are able to listen to them sympathetically, have empathy in them, who help them and try to minimize and reduce their pain and suffering. That institution is police. That is the first stop for anybody who is afflicted by any injustice. Thirdly, there is no development in the society unless there is peace and order. And we are the people who ensure peace and order. So given the attraction for the uniform, given the possibility of serving people at the earliest, given the possibility of bringing a smile on the faces of the people who are distressed, who have been wronged, and ensuring that they get justice, from the government, from the department, were very, very major pull for me to join this service. Now, as far as civil services are concerned, civil service exam is a gamut of is common exam for a number of services. Sometime it could be even 20, 25 such services. So what happens that when you decide to take this exam, the requirements of this exam are: one, you should be reasonably intelligent; two, you should have understood the subject which you have studied in your graduation or the subject which you are going to opt as an optional; thirdly, you should be able to analyze the interrelationship of different things, events, places, timing, reasons, and should be able to form a view or an opinion about that. Also, you should be in a position to, or you should have a habit of doing sustained hard work over a long period of time, and you should have a reasonable understanding of the things that are happening around you. These are the requirements for civil services. So any candidate who has these requirements is a fit candidate to be selected. Now, let me tell you that we who have qualified civil services exam and have been allotted some service are no different from you all. I'm not having 4 hands or 10 head or 4 legs or 4 eyes. I'm a normal, simple human being like all of you. I was a student some 25 years back. I was very similar to you, probably not as privileged as many of you would have been. I was educated in a vernacular medium school. We didn't have the facility of internet or computer or even newspaper. Forget other things. We had a lot of difficulties. Nobody was there to guide us. There was no mentor. And whatever we did was trial and error. My session got delayed by 2 years. So a graduation course started in 3 years. It took me 5 years to complete that course. 1 year delay and 1 year walkout in Putnam City, unfortunately, in my batch. So quite a few difficulties we had had. But the hope and optimism was always there. And the faith on your own capabilities that, yes, I shall be able to do it. I shall be able to overcome all the difficulties. If we have this faith in ourselves and faith in our Creator, and we are able to do hard work consistently over a period of time, what you call as tenacity, and if we are able to move in the right direction, read right material, and apply these things, the principles that I just outlined in our studies, I think anybody can qualify in civil services exam. It is not a very, very difficult exam, yes, but it requires a lot of patience, a lot of hard work, and a good understanding. Please understand, we who have qualified civil services are not exceptional people. If we are exceptional, it is just one count. And the count is that we are able to do hard work and sustain that hard work over a long, long period of time. Maybe I would say from graduation onwards, at least, that is those 5-6 years, we've stayed hard work. Anybody who is able to do it will qualify.
Indeed, sir. Again, it was quite inspiring message from your side. I'm sure the civil service aspirants, those who are watching this session, they are surely going to inspire from this. Sir, my next question to you, or rather say, sir, may I request you to please explain our viewers the significance of We the People of India in the preamble of Indian Constitution.
As I was speaking in reply to the question on rights and duties, you see, we have two concepts in political science. One is state and one is government. Now, if you look at human being intrinsically, a human being has 3 fundamental capabilities or qualities. One, a human being is an intellectual being. That means it has wisdom and it accumulates wisdom over a period of time. That means we have a history, we have civilizational things which are passed on as legacy. We learn, we accumulate that learning and we pass on that learning, and our learning process goes on. That is why we refine our technology. That is why we refine our knowledge. That is why we have developed the art of criticism. And that is why we are more and more exact in sciences and in social sciences also. By and large, now we are reaching to a stage of general acceptance of certain theories. So we are an intellectual being. We are a wise people. One. Second, as I spoke, we are a moral being. When we are a moral being, that means that we decide between what is good and what is bad. We decide what we should do and what we should not do. We decide what is to be achieved in life and what is to be discarded in life. The entire foundation of law, it comes from this morality, because we pass judgment on acts, on actions and thought of human, other human beings and ourselves also. Sometimes you may be thinking something and you say, no, it's not good. I should not think this way. So we are a moral being. And third, we have an aesthetic sense. That means that we love beauty. We are attracted by beauty in whatever form, be it a flower, be it a person, be it a place, be it an architecture, be it something from nature. And we love beauty. We are attracted towards beauty and want to be away from ugly things. Now, these three things lead us to one. We develop our culture and civilization. For example, compare it with, say, tiger or lion. For last 40 or 1,000 years, the technique of hunting of a tiger or lion has not changed. It has seen no improvement because that is intrinsic, instinctive. Now, every tiger or lion cub will kill the prey in the same fashion, in the same manner. Two things. One is your claws and one is your teeth. They're using that technology only and there has been no change. While human beings, we started from, say, horseback or horse as a medium of our conveyance. Then we made block cart and we invented wheel. Then we came on horse-driven cart, then to motors, now plane, now spacecraft, shuttles. So look, only now I was seeing a video of a Japanese bullet train which was clocking around 400 or 500 kilometers per hour. That is the kind of thing that we have developed. So what has happened? These things are possible only when we have a system whereby we ensure that the misuse of the discretion and will that human beings have, you have capability and you have opportunity. When these two meet, then you are able to execute a plan. Now, this plan may be good or bad. You may hurt somebody or you may do something good. We have a nature. We might hurt other people. We might trample upon the rights of other people. We might injure other people. We might take over their property, their possessions. We might abuse somebody. So, human beings have decided to form a system of protection of themselves as a society. That is state. State is one institution. As Rousseau said, it is a social contract between different members of the society. And in that social contract, we surrender some part of our freedom. That is how the state is able to impose tax on us. Nobody wants to give money, but we pay tax. Why? Because the state has to be sustained. I can go at any place. For example, there was pandemic here. And the right to movement was severely curtailed. We all adhere to that. Intrinsically, I wouldn't like to be confined to my house. I would like to roam around, go somewhere. But then state has imposed certain restrictions on my movement. So we have created a state. When we have created a state, then it has to function. It has to execute the will of the people. How does the will of people get reflected? First and foremost, people will form one basic tenet of governance, one basic law of governance, that is the constitution. Now, to implement the ideas and ideals of the constitution, you will have a system put in place, which is called government. Government will attempt to attain the goals and objectives which are given by the people of this country in the constitution of the country. So we the people are supreme. We the people are the one in which the sovereignty of the country is vested. We the people are the people who have actually constituted this state. That is why if you see the preamble of the constitution, you will find that it defines the nature of the state. We the people of India having constituted, you know, India into a sovereign, socialist, secular, democratic republic. Now, this is the nature of the state, which is being explained here. Then what will be the ideal of this state? So to attain, say, freedom, social, economic, political, and equality before law, and those things are there. If you read out the preamble, you will find all these things. And on what date we have adopted this, we have resolved to adopt this, that date is also mentioned. So that is what we the people mean. We the people means that it is the people of India who are the who are the actual holders of the sovereignty for this country. It is the people of India who have expressed their will in the form of our constitution. So the sovereignty of this country lies in the people of India. Will of the people of India is supreme. The people of India will give their verdict who will serve them as government. People of India will decide which law should be enacted. People of India will decide which law should be repealed. People of India will decide what will be the form of the government. So all the laws which are passed by the parliament is nothing but a reflection of the will of the people of the country. So we the people are actually the fountainhead, the source of entire power, which is given to the government. And we the people are the people who have constituted this Indian state and have defined the nature of this state. And we the people of India are therefore the basic constituent of this country.
Indeed, sir. Again, you have very beautifully explained and given a very detailed overview. And I think the viewers who are watching this session, they are surely going to learn many things from this. Sir, my next question to you is, how do you see the role of youth as a change agent in the India's development?
See, the youth of today will be the people who will run this government, this country tomorrow. Every generation comes with its own potential. And I strongly believe that as the generations come, they are having much more potential than what we had had. If you just compare the syllabus for class 10, say in 80s and in say 2020, what we used to study in say class 10, now the students are studying in class 8 or so. So this generation is very energetic, very capable, brilliant, I would say that. But every generation has its own problems. Our generation was not so conformist generation. We did not have something called peer pressure. Everybody must conform to certain norms. That was not so important for us. And we were, in a way, kind of thick-skinned people. I mean, somebody is scolding us, didn't make much difference to us. But now, the generation which is coming, it is very, very, I should say,
sensitive
to any assault on their dignity or even something being told to them harshly. There are a lot of peer pressure and their own academic rigor is quite high. The hard work that they need to do is pretty much more than what we had had. But this generation also has resources to meet these challenges. They have internet, they have technology on their fingertips. We learned computer when we went to Mussoorie for training, civil services training. Then for the first time, I learned computer. Now my kids have learned computer in class 1 or class 2. I mean, a small child also would know how to put on a song or go to YouTube or do something, send a message, something like that, which it took time for us to learn. So this generation is a generation which is exposed to a variety of knowledge pretty early in their life, unlike the old generations. But at the same time, this generation is also a stressed out generation. We had much less stress in our time than these people. We were not so bothered about percentages or marks. Yeah, we need to do well. Of course, that was always there in the back of the mind. But this competition for 98% or 99%, or sometimes I read about colleges where the cutoff was 100%. In our generation, it was never so. I mean, I scored 82% in my 10th exam and I was among the toppers in Bihar. You understand that thing? Now, if my child would bring 82%, she wouldn't get even a decent college, forget good college. So that is the difference. So the pressures of this generation are also much more. And expectations from this generation are also much more. But all in all, I feel and I believe that this generation is really, really a very capable, very optimistic, very technology savvy, and is a generation which is capable of doing hard work also. And I have lots of hope from this generation.
Indeed, sir. I think it's a kind of privilege today we got to hear all those things from you. And as you are sharing your many of your example of your times and comparing with the recent new generation. And I think it will many of our viewers going to learn many things from this. Sir, my next question to you is, which is most interesting case that you have solved? What are major takeaways which you could share with viewers so they get inspired from it?
See, every case is unique, different, and there have been a number of major cases that we were able to solve. Some would be regarding body offenses, killing of people, property theft, dacoity, robbery. Some would have been hacking and all that. But the takeaway from all these investigations is this, that I learned that as somewhere I read about Einstein, who said, in this world, only two things are infinite, the universe and human stupidity. I'm not so sure about the former. The universe might be finite. Human stupidity is infinite. So having spent 25 years in this service and seeing these things from a very close quarter, what I have understood is that nothing is final. In this world, nothing is final. No relationship is absolute. Nobody has to be taken on face value. In God we trust, the rest we verify. So that has been one major takeaway for me. Second takeaway that I see is that innate goodness of people is still intact. Even though we see a lot of aberrations here and there, but by and large, people are still good. They are still God-fearing. They still believe in good and bad. And society as a whole does not approve of bad things. There may be exceptions. Society as a whole does not approve of shortcuts. It does not approve of taking wrong means for a right end. Also, nothing is easy unless you have put in your best. You have to be very, very clear in your fundamentals and basics. That is what learning teaches us, that you should know your fundamentals, you should know your basics, and you should be firm on that. And you should know that in human behavior, nothing is final until it is verified. So I have learned to verify. That has resulted in me not trusting many, many people. And I have been, I see, like any other person, we too have suffered heartbreaks. We too have suffered people breaching the trust, people misusing your friendship, people misusing the relationships that they develop with you, and all kind of nonsense that you see in human beings. We are also victim of that. We are members of society. We may not be able to express that openly, but let me tell you, we remain human beings, and we do not become heartless because we wear a uniform. We are very much similar to you, but yes, on the surface, you will not find us. You'll find us very tough. You'll find us kind of, hard-hearted and no nonsense. But back in our house, back with our family, we are similar human beings as anybody else. And we have the same fragilities. We have the same weaknesses. And we get affected emotionally in the similar way as anybody else. Yes, probably this training teaches us how to control and conceal those emotions in a better fashion and to focus on your work, on your job, despite whatever happens to you. See, you have seen our people getting hurt, getting maimed, getting killed, getting kidnapped in different scenarios. And still, and getting abused also, getting stoned also. But we never give up. We keep doing our work and we feel that contentment from within. People may not appreciate, they may not speak good at times. They may criticize us, they may be very harsh on us. But down into your soul and into your heart, you know that what you have done is the correct thing. you have discharged your responsibility, and this is the responsibility imposed by you by law, imposed on you by law, and you have abided by law. And at the end of the day, this contentment that I have been fair, I have been just, and I have done to the best of my capability is something which will see you through all these despairs and distresses and depressions and bad times.
Indeed, sir. Again, it was quite insightful answer from your side. Sir, my next question to you is, IPS officer plays the pivotal role in establishing law and order at the grassroots level in the country. The post of an IPS officer is an achievement in itself. The Indian Police Service is a place where you can really make a difference to society at all levels with direct interaction with public. So it's a kind of request to you. Please tell, put some light on the life of an IPS officer, the struggle they endure every day so that normal civilians sleep in peace.
Well, the life of an IPS officer and any, for that matter, any policeman is tough, if not doubly tough. First and foremost, our working hours are undefined. We are supposed to be on duty 24 hours. That means even if we come back from our offices, if something happens, some emergency takes place, some crime takes place, then we need to rush and start doing our work. So one is you get much less time with your family and much less number of holidays than the normal people. They enjoy their Sundays, they enjoy their Saturdays, and they enjoy other festivals. We are on duty on festivals. I'll explain myself. I mean, while I was in executive policing during Eid, in the morning I used to go pray, come back, change into my uniform and go into my area and see to it that things are fine and well taken care of. Even while going to for this prayer, I used to take location that bandobas is there, people have reached their spots, everything's all right, things have been checked, it has been ensured there is no untoward incident would take place. And this is similar for every other bandobas. Ganpati, for example, procession is the biggest procession here in Mumbai and also in Maharashtra. Then Durga procession, then Holi, then Diwali, and we are on duty. So, but, you know, it is that we have consciously chosen this life. So I'm not complaining. I'm just telling you the difference that that happens. So one, that there are no fixed working hours. So you may be out anytime. And since there are no fixed working hours, therefore the food, taking food on time becomes a challenge at many places. You are on duty and then it's difficult to eat and all those things. So many of us suffer because of that. Thirdly, as I've explained to you, that we are on duty on festivals. So we do not get that time off as anybody else gets. Also, when people come to us, they're in distress, they're in despair, something wrong has happened to them, some injustice has taken place, somebody has trampled upon their rights and all that. So it's not a very good scene to see dead bodies, to see injuries, to see rape taking place, to see a dacoity taking place or robbery taking place and similar kind of things. Somebody's account has been hacked and lots of money has been taken out. So we meet people who are quite unhappy and who have been victims. So that is something which affects us. I remember long back when I joined service, I think my first charge was in Jalgaon district in 1999-2000. So there's a board in front of my chair. Now this is called crime board. Now, every morning I used to go sit on my chair and have a look on that board. So it starts with murder, attempt to murder, dacoity, robbery, rape, theft, this and that. I kept reading for so many days. Then finally I said, please take out that board and let us put it on my computer screen. So you understand that the environment is stressful and you need to keep your positivity intact and you need to read and you need to reflect on life and every other and other things so that negativity goes away. So that is there. And also because you get less time with your family and children, so a lot of work or responsibility shifts on your spouse. And it's a difficult balance which you have to achieve. Also, you do not get many holidays. So people go here and there to tourist places, to hill stations, to this and that. Sometimes we may not be getting that thing also. So it's difficult, though situation has improved in last many years. And now it is easy to get a holiday and to move and even travel to foreign countries. So in a way, it is a challenging life. But remember one thing, that this challenge is what makes life worth living. If you're able to discharge these responsibilities well, then you'll get a contentment from inside, from within. And you will understand and realize that I'm doing something positive. I'm doing something purposeful. I'm actually serving my people, and I'm returning back something to the society from which I've taken so much. So all in all, it's a kind of, it's a trade-off between the goods and not so good thing that life encompasses. And you have to choose, you have to take a call. And you have to remember one thing. See, I didn't want to become a doctor because a doctor had very erratic working hours. Especially if you're a surgeon, then a lot of good surgeries used to take place late at night or early in the morning. So I thought I will not choose a profession where I have to work, where I cannot sleep in night, and where I have to give up my sleep for the sake of something. But now the service, and after having spent 25 years in this service, I realized everything comes with some good and some not so good things. So police also, we have night rounds, and we have visitations, and something happens at night, then there's no excuse. You have to go and rush immediately. So that way, I think every service has this kind of pros and cons. But all in all, I feel, person like me, feels happy and contented that he or she has been able to serve the people of the country, the society, and has contributed his might or bit in ensuring that life, property, and dignity of the people remains free from threats and remains in good condition.
All right, sir. We are very proud of you and on the officials like you, that you are the people, those who are us for all the times. And I would like to tell my viewers that sir is very famous poet also, and he has recited his poetry all over the world. Sir, may I request you to give one piece of advice to all the viewers, those who are watching this session, but in the language of poetry?
You see, poetry is nothing but an outflow of the thought process, which is going on in your mind for a long, long time. So somewhere I've written, okay, this couplet, in fact, this is my message also. Okay. Yeh hai daure hawas, lekin aisa bhi kya? Yeh hai daure hawas, lekin aisa bhi kya? Agree that this is an age of greed and desires, but nevertheless, yeh hai daure hawas, lekin aisa bhi kya? Aadmi kam se kam aatmi to rahe. Human must remain human first, then only other things will come. So the humanity must remain intact. We must remain human, and we must behave like human beings. We are not robots, and we are not greedy vultures. We live in a society, and in society, as a member of society, other people have certain right over us as we have on them. So we need to treat the people who are not so privileged with a lot of empathy and compassion. We need to understand that in our society, in Oriental society, the difference in position generates a lot of social behavior pattern. Like, whoever is elder to me, I must respect that person. I may address that person in an honorific manner. I must never abuse somebody. And I must not be a nuisance to my neighbors and other members of the society. And I must be a productive member of the society so that my society becomes stronger, and consequently my country becomes stronger. And if something wrong is happening at some place, and if I can contribute in minimizing that impact or minimizing the genesis of that thing, I must do that. So I feel, all in all, that poetry and literature is nothing but what you see, what you observe, what you pass through, both externally and internally, when it is churning out in your mind and you develop an insight into something, then that insight comes out in the form of a story or a couplet or a memoir or a biography or anything for that matter, any work of art, a sculpture, a painting, you know, a musical piece, something. But that comes out, and I would suggest youth that do have a hobby, do something which you love doing. If you can sing, sing. If you can play something, play. If you can do something which helps other members of the society, and if you love that social work, please do it. Whatever hobby, if somebody has a hobby of planting trees, let him plant the trees. Somebody has a hobby of, say, cleaning up a beach, let him or her clean the beach. Or for that matter, anything which appeals to us, which gives us catharsis. And remember one thing, if you do something which you really love doing, a lot of your stress and strain will go away. So that is cathartic. So if you are singing, if you are swimming, if you are running, if you are playing, if you are reading, or you are writing, or you are acting, anything which takes away your pain and gives meaning to your life, please do it.
Very meaningful, sir, indeed. And I can say the kind of energy you brought into this session was very inspiring. And trust me, sir, it is one of the most inspiring conversations I have ever had on personal level. Thank you so much, sir, for joining and giving your important time. It was a healthy discussion with you on the topic. It was nice talking to you. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Pleasure.
Thank you so much.
Bye. Sit on the ground is where I stand. Never give up. That was always the plan. It's so cold outside. I'm alone. I'm alright. It's so cold outside. I'm alone.